Hello, sir.
Hello, guys. Nice to see you. How are you doing? How is the start of semester is going?
Quite easy.
That's good. Good.
Hello.
Hello, guys. Nice to see you.
Hello.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Bye.
Good afternoon.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, let's wait for a few more seconds to let more people join who is interested.
Good afternoon.
Hi.
Afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Hi, hi.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
Hello. Good afternoon.
Hello, nice to see all of you. I was just asking how, guys, the start of semester is going for you. Hopefully everything is smoothly.
Yeah.
Good, good. Easy is good, but keep in mind that usually it's easy until first midterm, so be aware of that.
You are being extremely optimistic.
I don't know. Maybe I'm optimistic, maybe you are optimistic. It's not so bad to be optimistic, just a bit of realistic also will not hurt you. Just be aware that don't put things in the long drawer and don't forget about them. Need to work continuously every day. Not 24/7, of course, just systematically and continuously. Okay, optimists always win, that is good. Let's be optimists. So, I guess most of people who wanted to attend are already here. If not, they can join on the way. Now, I think it makes sense to continue with our previous discussion, in particular, to answer some of your questions regarding the organization of our course and some technical moments of your evaluating your work and stuff like that. I'm sure that some of you still have questions, and we can discuss them right now. So you are welcome to ask. So I will, while you consider what to ask, I will just remind you that like during previous meeting, we discussed some key organizational moments in our course, and your final grade will consist of like three main contributions. So first is homework assignments. Weekly, you will get 10-12 problems per week to solve via Long Kappa. Keep in mind that we are still in the process of establishing final list of students for each section. Somehow, best to my knowledge, there is some movements from one section to another, and it looks like more students want to be in sections from 1 to 4 and less in 5-6, probably just because they are later scheduled. There is some flexibility, but please keep in mind that definitely cannot be this balance. So we definitely need to have more or less the same amount of of students in each section. So since these changes are still going on, we cannot have the final list of students for each section and proceed further with sending them to our LONCAPA administrator, Azamat, to prepare this LONCAPA accounts for you guys, so you will have access once it's done to LONCAPA. But that's not a problem because we don't have any home assignments, as I mentioned, during this week. And second week, it will be only for training, so it will not be evaluated and will not contribute towards your final grade. So the second, so this component, like homeworks, will contribute 20% towards your total grade. Another 20% will originate from your laboratory work, so please be aware of that and be in contact with your laboratory assistant because this should be done in time. It will be quite a challenging process if you need to, if you miss a lab and need to repeat it in some later time, that taking into account all these organizational moments with the labs, it's not so easy. So do it in time and pay attention to the quality of your lab report. That is very important. And of course, the dominant contribution to your final grade, like 60% of it, will be defined by your performance at midterms and three midterms and final exam, which have the same weight. So they all of them will contribute equally to your final grade. And the schedule of these midterms is available in the manual. Final exam will be scheduled later at the end of the course. So again, also midterms and exams will be carried out via LONCAPA, and that's why you feel already that together with home assignments and all midterms and exam, 80% of your final grade will be directly related with your ability to follow rules of LONCAPA and submit in the right format. So that is the key requirement for you guys. I mentioned this many times and I believe I will repeat it again and again because this is very important. Don't miss this point because your answer, even if it's correct, will not be accepted if it's not in the correct format. So LONCAPA obviously will not accept it. Other from that, that's, I think all questions can be discussed on the way and we can solve it. So any questions from you guys? Oh, I believe my explanation was really clear. Over 100 people understood it. That is very nice. I didn't expect, but you surprised me. Then it's good, great. So we can start our discussion about physics. So obviously one of the key requirements you need to know within this course, it's like in those anecdotes, the name of professor and the name of the topic. So we are going to study physics, and physics is science about fundamentals of nature, which surround us everywhere and with which we deal every day in our life. So homework, so there is a question in the chat. So if the homework three will have questions related to all topics from 3 weeks, yeah, I think so. There is a chance, not necessarily, but but actually just these topics during the first week are very distributed, I would say, not like units and vectors. I believe we will just now today we'll discuss units and dimensional, and dimensional analysis. That's the key message I would like to deliver. But vectors, I guess I will just introduce it shortly before we start motion in two dimensions. Because that's where vectors are actually appearing. First, after this dimension analysis, we will focus on motion in one dimension where we don't have any vectors and the direction of motion is defined by the sign of the displacement. So should you use, should you watch all videos in the manual? It's up to you what works for you better. We can only propose you different options. Of course, the main source of information is the textbook because like lectures, video lectures, they highlight probably the key things, but it's not a textbook where all details are described. And for sure, textbook is the main source of information, but in addition, some lectures could be very, very useful. How do you work on lab and if we're not having any equipment to use for? Okay, I understand your concerns regarding labs and equipment, of course, taking into account this condition of online teaching, online classes. As the labs will, they are recorded. So the labs were performed by our lab assistants and they are recorded. So you will have access to the recorded labs like video files. You will observe these video files, get data from observing the process of experiment. And then once you have the data, you will approach it as under regular conditions, because once you have data, you have to carry out some data analysis and make conclusions out of it and perform step-by-step all requirements which are set in the scope of this laboratory work. But yeah, it's for now, it's organized in this way that you will work with some recorded labs. Zoom meetings are. So another question was in the chat about our Zoom meetings. So it's question and answer sessions and problem solving. So it's question and answer sessions for sure. It's not problem solving. Because problem solving, as I mentioned earlier, is recitation. That's where we're specifically dedicated to practicing in solving problems. Here, we will cover some lecture material, some material from the textbook during our lectures in parallel with this question and answers and discussion. That's how we work. The main goal of our online lectures is to try to explain and understand the some physical concepts and derive equations, understand how we come up with these equations and what is physical meaning of the equations and terms which are in the equation. So your first weekly assignment will be next week, correct? As answered in the chat. That will not be evaluated, will not contribute to your final grade. It will be a test home assignment so you can practice with answering in long cup. Okay. So good. If you have questions on the way, you're welcome to ask. So we can continue this our discussion. And obviously, taking into account the organization of physics as a field of science and human activity, it is divided into experimental and theoretical physics. So obviously, initially, at the early stage of the development of physics, everyone was experimentalist. We just did some, perform some empirical observations of nature, trying to find some relationships between different processes. And one thing when we explain it in words or draw it on some walls of caves, but other thing when we come to that level of development, when we have some mathematical apparatus and understand how applies this mathematical apparatus in order to explain nature around us. So that is already contribution from theoretical physics, which gives the explanation of observed things. However, that can be changed actually. Like nowadays, that could be in both directions. Theoretical physics either can explain already observed phenomena or predict some new which haven't been tested yet, and experiments were not carried out on these particular phenomena or processes. So in that case, when experimentalists are able to use some of this theoretical prediction and design experiment in that way in order to prove this prediction, or in the contrary, prove that it's wrong. So that is another possible interaction between theoretical and experimental physics, but they definitely are quite tightly connected. Nowadays, taking into account the complexity of both apparatus of experimental and theoretical physics, usually scientists are quite separated in terms of their specialization. They are nowadays either experimentalists or theoreticians. That's physically impossible to be expert in both fields on the top level, because both are quite complicated and require a lot of time and expertise to do a good job. So that's why people organize collaboration between experimentalists and theoreticians. And that is how modern science works and modern physics works. So me personally, I am an experimentalist. I work in the field of physics of semiconductors and semiconductor devices. In particular, I investigate electronic and optoelectronic processes in organic plastic optoelectronic and photovoltaic devices, in organic solar cells, in other words. So organic plastic semiconductors is quite interesting material. So it's we expect that it's an isolator. However, because that's our everyday experience, usually we have this plastic insulator materials in electrical wires, electrical circuits. However, it depends on chemical structure of organic materials. They can, some of them can conduct electricity surprisingly quite well and contribute to this wide variety of inorganic semiconductors in terms of development of new electronic and optoelectronic materials, with additional features of plastic could be like bendable or stretchable, could be transparent and still conduct electricity. So quite interesting applications. So that is shortly about my background, because I believe it kind of important that you know my field of like expertise, and particularly am I experimentalist or theoretician, because it also will impact how I see, even in the scope of our course, this material, and probably also how I will teach it. So it has some teaching, some impact on teaching style too. So we will deal with mechanics, molecular physics, and thermodynamics during this semester. And obviously we'll start with mechanics as the first big and important part of general physics. And we start with units and dimensions. So do you know, guys, what is the difference between units and dimensions? Any ideas?
We have only three dimensions, like length, mass, and time. In the units, mm-hmm. there are so many, like kilograms, seconds, and a lot of.
Sure, sure. So it's all correct. In other words, we can say that the distance between two points can be measured in centimeters, meters, kilometers. Those are units. They can be different, and it's just some accepted format of measuring the distance, which can be changed just for our convenience. For instance, can be measured in inches, which is accepted in North America. And that will be okay. It will also give us quite accurate, the same distance between two points. However, this distance has some physical meaning, that's like dimension, which comes with the physical meaning to a quantity. So quantity is just a number if we want to associate with some physical nature, we need to provide some dimension for this quantity. And in this case, it's like length. So dimension of this distance, which can be measured in different units, is length. And this dimension is not changing. We can change units, but it just has fundamental physical meaning, and this physical meaning is defined by dimension. So which are three main dimensions which we are going to work with in mechanics? You actually mentioned, we already discussed this length. Mass, okay, we have the answer in our chat. Length, mass, and time, absolutely right. These are the three dimensions which we need for our work. So we mentioned that dimension defines physical meaning. And from these, automatically, we get another conclusion, which is already like first the fundamental of dimensional analysis. If we have two equations, they are equal to each other. Definitely, if they both describe some physical quantity, dimensions of the left and right side should be equal, should be the same. So when we deal with dimensions, we operate with dimensions as algebraic numbers, like in algebraic equations. So we have some complicated equation describing some physical quantity. We need to know dimensions of each term of this equation, and then we can calculate the dimension of all this equation, which is dimension of the physical quantity which it gives. So we can put sign equal between two physical quantities only when dimensions are the same. So It kind of makes sense because if we, well, we can compare time, it can be larger interval of time or smaller interval of time. We cannot compare time and mass. These are different, they have different physical meanings. So it doesn't make physical sense to compare these physical quantities. So that is very important because you can use it to double check if the derivation of your equations is correct. So, and that what you should do always when you derive like final equation for any problem which you solve, or in the near future, it will not be just some textbook problem, but it could be a real research problem which you will deal with. You will definitely work with some set of equations and try to express the same physical quantity with a different set of equations in order to put them together and get some unknown parameters out of such new equation. On every step, you definitely need to check the carry out this dimensional analysis in order to be sure that the left side dimension is equal to the is the same as right side dimensions. This will help you a lot in order to avoid possible misinterpretations and just wrong calculations, because if you further go with a wrong equation, substitute numerical values, get wrong answer, okay, but at that point you don't know where you made mistake. Is it problem with your equation, or it's just some technical problem in the substitution of numerical data? So in order to avoid these uncertainties, it is very important to do the dimensional analysis and check it. However, it's not only about this. So let's say this works when you have the model, you have some established model which clearly and accurately describes certain physical quantity. And that model is established and checked. However, sometimes you you deal with some new in a new not established field, and at early stage of your research, before you come to this point when you have established model, quite often it happens that you need to estimate value of some physical quantity, and this estimation can definitely help you a lot in order to find the direction of your research and carry out in the most efficient way, avoiding some possible delays and unnecessary drawbacks on your way. So for this purpose, dimensional analysis is also very useful, because even if you don't know the exact equation, which you don't have established model for the process or physical quantity you are interested in, based on some key physical quantities which are known, you can use them in dimensional analysis and derive an approximate equation which will give a chance to estimate the value with the accuracy of certain constant. And that is a big deal, because okay, constant can be different, of course, but it dimensional analysis will give you the form of the equation which describes your unknown physical quantity. And that is very important and useful. So let us consider two examples of this and discuss how they can be helpful. So let me switch my camera. Okay. So before we start with this examples, we definitely need to write down some key statements, actually the most important statement of dimensional analysis, which we already discussed in words, but it's better to have it written down. So these are the dimensions we will work with, like three main dimensions: mass, length, and time. And if, for instance, we have some equation in the, like dimensional equation in the, so we have left and right side of the equation, and if we write dimensional equations for this equation, we will get something like this: m in the power of a, l in the power of b, t.
Excuse me, Professor, yes. Is there any way that you could show us your screen, but a little bit bigger, or is it just my problem that your screen is small?
Try to bend his video.
And, yeah, the quality, and the quality of the picture is quite low.
So you can you see what I write?
Yes, but
you can see it, but it's very blurry.
Yes.
Yes, we blurry. Can see that.
Okay, yeah. We'll see. I guess this is the limit of my HDMI capture system, which I use for.
What about screen demonstration?
But can you start the demonstration of your screen?
Oh, that is the problem, because I don't have a screen with where I can write. So that's why I use a laptop, and this is connected via this capture system, and I use it as another external webcam. Okay, yeah, I guess let's see what we can do in the future. I guess not much right now. I used to use the same system for previous lectures, and was not the highest quality, of course, but definitely could be seen. Yeah,
I can see it perfectly, so I can share my screen, guys, if you want.
Oh, okay. That's kind of strange that someone can see it well and someone cannot. Maybe that's some issue with internet connection. Yeah, you can try, but also, yeah, if internet connection is poor, then of course it will be blurred. Let's see how it goes. And definitely this will be in like recorded, and there should be acceptable quality. It's not perfect quality, but definitely acceptable quality to see what is. And now I see my screen, which is shared with you, and the quality is decent. I mean, not great, but quite easy to read everything. Okay, so this is our left side. And our right side is, let's say, the same mass in the power of x, length in the power of y, and time in the power of z. So this main statement that left and right side dimensions should be equal means that this power for each of the dimension should be also equal. So A is equal to X, B is equal to Y, and C is equal to Z. So this is our statement of equal dimensions from left and right side. So now let us consider such example when we have some position x, and we know that position is proportional to acceleration. Let's assume that we have just zero initial velocity and some constant acceleration. So a and t. So obviously we understand that this position of our body will be proportional to acceleration, and also time interval during which this motion will happen. However, we are not sure about exact form of this dependence. And that's what we will do probably next lecture. We will derive this equation with all constants, but now with the help of dimensional analysis, we can estimate how it looks. Sorry. So in order to proceed further with this example, we need to write down the dimensions of the left and right side. So dimensions of X will be length L. And we can also write it in another form. It will be L in the power of 1 times T in the power of 0. So we can write this because it doesn't matter what is in power of 0. It will be just unity. Another like this right side. So here we have acceleration. And acceleration, dimensions of acceleration is length divided by time square. And obviously, dimensions of dimension of time is time t. So now we can write this dimensional equation. And for that, we since we don't know the exact format of this proportionality, we can put here power of n and here power of m. So from the left side, we will have L in the power of 1 times T in the power of 0. And this is equal to L over T square in the power of n times T in the power of m. So let's open this parenthesis and we get L in the power of n times t in the power of m minus 2n. So now we have the same format of left and right side. We have L and t here. And now we can write two equations for getting unknown n and m. So it will look like n is equal to unity automatically, it's clear. And then for the second unknown m, we have m minus 2n is equal to 0. So we have this and this. So means that m minus 2n is should be equal to 0. Taking into account that n is unity, we can write for m that it's equal to 2. So what we end up with, we can substitute instead of this n and m their values, and we get that x, this like position of this body, is proportional to a. N is unity, so we don't write anything, times t squared. So that is already a big deal because we know the general trend, like form of the equation, which describes this dependence. And that can help us to estimate the position. Of course, this is not the fully correct answer. We cannot put here sign equal because it is dimensional analysis can provide us with equation which has accuracy limited by a constant. So we will show later that this position will be equal to a times t squared divided by 2. And within accuracy of this 1/2 coefficient, we can get this equation from the dimensional analysis, which can be very neat for some cases when we need to estimate the value of some physical quantity without knowing the exact model, quantitative model, which describes this. So let us go to another example, which is a bit more interesting. So let's assume that we have a star. Which parameters of the star can be determined from simple observation? There are actually two most important parameters. It is mass of the star, and also its radius. So let's write it down here. Mass of the star and radius of the star. So now, once we just from observations determine these two parameters, the next one, let's say we want to know to estimate some like pressure inside the core of this star. So how do we approach such task? So pressure we want to estimate. Obviously that pressure will depend on these two parameters, because the bigger the star and the more mass will be in this volume of this star, the higher pressure should be in the center. However, we are not sure, we don't know exactly how this dependence will look like. So in addition to these two parameters, since it is correlated with the pressure, we need to take into account the gravitational constant, because that defines how matter interacts with gravitational field and how much it eventually will push the central area of the star from all sides and create this high pressure in the core. So we can write that, and sorry, here should not be equal, should be proportional. Gravitational constant times mass times radius. So we know that this should be somehow proportional to these parameters. However, we don't know even if it's directly or reversely proportional to some of them. So now what we can write, we can just write this dimensional equation, and let it be like this. So dimension of pressure should be equal to dimension of the right side of this equation. So dimension of gravitational constant in the power of x, dimension of the mass of the star in the power of y, and dimension of the radius of the star in the power of z. Now let us write down, we didn't discuss these physical quantities. So right now we don't know their dimensions, but if we discuss these physical constant parameters in the future, we will define its physical meaning, and then automatically we will know their dimensions. But now in this example, we just write it down here. So dimension of pressure is mass in the power of one, but we can like skip this one, actually. It's mass in times lens in the power of minus one times time in the power of minus two. So dimension of gravitational constant will be mass in the power of minus one, lens in the power of three, time in the power of minus two. And obviously dimension of the mass of the star is just mass, and dimension of radius So by the way, what is dimension of radius?
Lens.
Lens, exactly. Can be measured in kilometers, meters, centimeters, but dimension of radius is lens. Now we have all dimensions, so we can substitute them in these dimensional equations and get what we need out of it in terms of some system of three equations. So let us do it. So we have mass times L in the power of minus one times T in the power of minus two. So this is dimension of pressure. It is equal to the dimension of gravitational constant. And this is M in the power of minus one, L power of three, T in the power of minus two, and all this in the power of X, according to this dimensional equation. Multiply M in the power of Y and times L in the power of Z. Okay, now we need to open this parenthesis. So what do we have here? Will be M minus X times MY. So it will be M in the power of minus plus Y. Yeah. Oh, guys, please maybe switch off microphone if you don't ask any questions. We don't have this background noise. Please switch off your microphones if you hear me. Apparently they don't hear me.
Oh, okay. Paolo, could you please mute yourself?
So how do we switch off the
yeah.
And who is talking now?
Try to write quicker.
Mute.
Open.
Not clear. Okay, I guess it is stopped. Okay, let us continue. So then we have this lens. It will be three times X and plus Z. So it will be L in the power three times X plus Z. And then we have our time. It will be T in the power of minus two X. So now we have the same format, MLT, MLT, and the power of next to each of the dimensions should be equal. Based on this, we can write the system of three equations. So it will be minus X plus Y is equal to unity. 3x plus z is equal to minus 1 and 2 minus 2x is equal to minus 2. We have three unknown and three equations, so that is easy to solve. From the bottom one, we already see that x is equal to unity. And then so on, we can solve it for Y and Z. So Y will be two and Z will be minus four. So now we can write, rewrite this initial equation, which is with the help of dimensional analysis. Let's go to another slide. Gives us the real form of this dependence with accuracy to a certain constant. So that will be pressure is proportional to gravitational constant. So pressure inside the center of the star, proportional to star mass in the second power, and reversely proportional to the radius of the star in the power of four. So this is obtained, this equation is obtained just based on dimensional analysis and provide us an opportunity to estimate this pressure without developing some complex analytical model for this particular physical quantity, which is of our interest. We can estimate it and get it with accuracy of about some constant. So if we consider now the most familiar to us star, which is our sun, let's take mass of the sun is 2 × 10⁻³ kilograms. Then radius of the sun is 7 × 10⁸ meters. If we substitute this with the value for gravitational constant, we get pressure estimated as 10⁻¹ bar. So bar, who doesn't know, is pressure of our atmosphere, Earth's atmosphere at the sea level. And this is something about 101,000 Pascal. So you see that units for pressure can be different. Like for instance, bar and Pascal can be also millimeters of mercury and other options. However, dimension is always the same because it defines physical meaning of pressure, and dimension of pressure, as we wrote previously, it's mass time length in the power minus one times time in the power minus two. So this is the highlight of the difference between units and pressure, and that should be clearly understood. So yeah, we, with the help of this dimensional analysis, without going into some hydrodynamics or laws of ideal gas approximations or some other, applying some other models, could get this estimating equation for the pressure inside the star just based on two empirically measured from observations parameters, mass and radius of a star, and we can estimate the pressure inside it. So that is the beauty of this dimensional analysis. Yeah, if you want to see some parts here, you're welcome. And definitely it worth keep this in mind and use when you have such an opportunity. It can save you a lot of time and still give you an option to estimate unknown physical quantity with a decent accuracy. Okay, I think this is pretty much everything what I wanted to tell you today. So if you have any questions, you're welcome. Yeah, sure, you can unmute yourself and ask questions, don't hesitate. Okay,
thank you. Will we have such type of questions in the quizzes or exam, and will there be given the dimensional analysis of every?
So I would say most likely you will not get exactly some task to carry out dimensional analysis, but that automatically implies actually for solving any problem, because in order to solve problem accurately with minimum chances of for your mistakes, you need to derive final equation first. If you deal with any sort of derivation of any equation, you need to double check if your derivation is correct. And the only like feasible and straightforward way to do it is to carry out dimensional analysis, or in other words, you can also use unit analysis, eventually can give you the same option to check. But dimensional analysis is more universal because, as we already know, dimensions don't change from the change of units of measurement. Units can be different, but dimensions are always the same for given physical quantities. And that means you need to carry out this dimensional analysis in order to double check. Of course, you can skip this. No one will ask you to provide this dimensional analysis in your final answer, because final answer in one kappa specifically, it will be just numerical answer. But again, you will have only one chance. If you made a mistake in derivation of your equation, substitute numerical data, get wrong answer, you lose points. So it is in your interest to give some time to this check, dimensional analysis, and then be sure, at least at this stage when your equation is derived, that it's derived properly, you didn't miss anything, and it is correct equation. So then you can already focus on substituting correct numerical values into it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. But that is a bit different from what we did here. I think this is a bit more interesting because here you kind of predict a new equation based on dimensional analysis, and you solve the system of equations, get values for the powers, and can predict how unknown physical quantity will be described with the set of parameters which you can provide. So that is quite interesting approach. That checking accurate, checking the correctness of deriving equation is quite a technical task, because you know units, you have already equation, you have you derive them based on known physical models. You don't invent any models on the way. You need to know them, and you just double check if left side is equal to the right side in terms of dimensions. That's all. So it's quite technical task. What we did here, we made some prediction, like some estimation of the physical quantity without using known physical models for deriving equation. And that is a bit different, and I think quite interesting.
Sorry for interrupting, but it's time for another lecture.
Yeah, sure, sure. No problems. And that's true. We need to keep an eye on the time and don't overshoot. Thank you very much for attention. It was a pleasure to see all of you. Hopefully you will continue visiting our online meetings.
So thank you too.
In future.
Thank you.
And
thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
Have a good day and take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Bye. Have a great day too.
Bye.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
This was an interesting lecture.
Bye.
Hope to see you in future. Bye.